to four. Wrapping up the victory. That's him.
Well, I love that song. It's been good for 60 years.
I wrote my gal a letter, and this is what I had to say. Man, you know how I feel if you ever had a gal like me.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. That right there is the Ravens coming to you. Oh, that's my song right there. I've been listening to that thing for over 60 years, and I still can't get enough of it. But we want to welcome everybody out there in the webcast and all over the world to our show, MPLStudio13.com. We're coming to you from downtown Millington, Tennessee, in this beautiful library. And we got a special guest today, Miss Joyce Barner. Welcome, Joyce.
Thank you.
Glad to have you.
Thank you so much.
This little young lady right here, she wrote her a book here recently and just finally got it out. And as you know, the reason we got this show, our news and our blues, is there's so many folks out there that have a talent. Now, Joyce got a talent of writing a book, getting a book published. We got some kids out there that can sing, play a guitar, play a bugle. They're into art, different things. But nobody has a way to expose them. They never, you can't get on Dancing with the Stars and who's going to be a king and who's going to sing and everything. So hopefully we've got several people that have been on there. Matter of fact, got a little gal brought me a CD I'm going to play for you in a little while. And she hopes somebody hears it. So you don't ever know. But right now I'm going to quit all this joining and talk to Joyce. And she's going to tell you about this book that the little gal wrote here. So, Joyce, where was this book? Where did all this stuff take place in your book?
It took place basically in Arkansas.
Okay, across the Big Creek.
Across the Big Creek.
All right.
Yes.
So, is it fact or fiction or both?
It's both.
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 So you let them figure it out. You don't know whether they're doing the fact or the fiction or what.
Yeah, the reader has to figure that out.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, that's good. You got to be smart to be able to do that.
Absolutely.
So. But what brought about that you decided, Joyce, when you wrote this book? Well, what made you, gave you incentive to write a book?
I've been wanting to write ever since I was a child. As a matter of fact, during World War II, I had an article printed in the McCrory Woodruff Leader, where you've been, at a book signing. I had them to print that poem many years ago, and I have written things basically all through the years. But this particular book was based, I haven't written a book before. They've just been articles and little stories. But this came a book as time went by, and it was partially things that's happened in my life and a lot of things that I just put in there for the time of it.
Yeah, well, I understand that. Now, folks at Tacoma, Washington, mm-hmm. have no idea. Now, where is McCrory and Whitehall? Where are they located?
Folks in Washington, Whitehall is in the state of Arkansas in the eastern part.
Okay.
It's basically country. That's cotton country, you could say. That's what people raise.
So it's pretty close. How close is it to Memphis?
Oh, it's about 100 miles.
Okay, so if anybody wants to take a vacation, go to McCrory, Arkansas, just head toward Memphis and then stop 100 miles before you get there, and you'll be right there at McCrory.
There you go.
All right, so on your, what is the name of your book, Joyce?
The name of it is Walking on Hot Coals.
There you go.
And I do have a copy with me.
All right, hold it up there.
May I show it?
Yeah.
You?
Oh, there you go, right there, Walking on Hot Coals. You see right here? Ladies and gentlemen, y'all see that right there? Ain't that pretty? I guarantee you that, George Barnes. So, you can get that anywhere.
At the Millington Library, where we presently are sitting. Also, on my email, if someone contacted me personally, I can mail them a copy. I have it on the library over in Arkansas, McCrory. So it's available if someone would like to have it.
So you decided recently that you're gonna write a book, but you had all of your stories, and it's about some of it's about your life, and some of it's, like we said, fact, fiction, you know, kind of interwoven, which is kind of, it really takes a lot of talent to be able to do that, because I can't do it. But how many was in your family growing up, George?
When I was growing up?
Yeah, back home.
I have one sister. Just one sister.
One sister. Okay. And your mom and your daddy. And what is it? Whitehall? Is that outside of?
Whitehall was just the name of a little community that was out of McCrory, about 15 miles, I guess, from McCrory.
Okay.
Actually, you know, no one would know but someone that had lived there.
Yeah.
Where is Whitehall? Well, you know, they wouldn't know.
Well, when you were growing up out there in we call the middle, that's about the same way I grew up. Anyway, he's out in the middle of nowhere. How'd your parents back in, what they call it, survive?
Survive basically by raising cotton. Most everybody was cotton farmers back then. But my dad had a series of things that he did in addition to that.
Yeah.
He was a barber. And he upset my mother many Sunday mornings by having people come in to get their hair cut when she's getting ready to go to church.
Well, I understand that.
He trapped fur in the winter to supplement our income back then.
All that information stuff you had about growing up, stuff you're talking about, that's all in your book, and how you grew up as a child there and out in the country. So.
Well, somewhat.
But it's all. But where'd you go to, what do you call it, high school?
Where'd you go to high school? You wouldn't have ever heard of this either, but it was a very special place because the Cotton Belt Railroad ran through there, and they paid taxes that enabled us to have a wonderful school, even though we were in the country. We had a gymnasium, inside gymnasium. Most everybody else had to play basketball on a dirt course.
Right, okay.
Yeah. We had a stage with a cyclorama, a curtain,
yeah.
Background, and where we would have plays. So we had radiator heat, so we had quite an uptown.
Oh, you was uptown then, back then, right?
It was.
Oh, okay, well, all right. After you got out of high school, what did you do then, George?
I went to college in Jonesboro. That was a state college. And I would go to school in the summer and teach in the winter.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. After you got out of college, somewhere along the line, now you had to get married. Now I don't know exactly when that transpired.
I got married during one of the periods of times that I was teaching in a little school out north of McCrory.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
So these folks down in Miss Dorothy Smith down in Pensacola, she probably ain't never seen you, so we're talking to her today.
I'm talking to her.
Well, that's
okay.
Right. Chuck and Dawn up there, and I got a good friend out there that had a knee replacement over George Dipper Gibson and Joe Lynn and Jean Becky there over there, and I just wanted to say hello to them, because the man, he was telling me he was hurting with his dear friend, and he's got a book and one thing and another, so. But anyway, so the dear friends, we got this thing going all over the world. I don't know how it gets there. I guess back get there about the same time we do. But anyway, how many kids do you have when you got married? How many children do you have?
I have four children.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Did you work them in the book too?
Basically, I have a little bit.
A little bit. Just,
yeah.
Just touch on a little bit all around
just,
there.
Just
so,
a little.
Well, where are you living now?
I live in Lakeland, Tennessee.
Lakeland. Okay, well, I know how long you and I know you the one and only Merle right there. How long y'all been married?
We about 28 years.
Hey.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, So I do know that you worked over at the Naval Base. This is Millington, ladies and gentlemen. We're about 15 miles roughly north of Memphis, if you don't know where we are in Millington. But anyway, I got a little girl that gave me her CD, and she's real proud of it. Genevieve, if I'm pronouncing that name right, Serviette. And I told her that I'd be taking that. Ladies and gentlemen, this is MPLStudio13.com. And I think that I tried to tell everybody that if you got some kind of talent, you got something you want to do or anything, come on down here and talk to us. So I'm going to play a little song here by Genevieve. And y'all listen up. South, you gotta have a good gospel song, I guarantee you.
That's beautiful.
Oh,
right, ladies and gentlemen, I hope y'all enjoyed that good gospel record. I mean, you can't get enough of that. As Jenny Zubiat came to me and brought me that, and I want y'all to listen to it. I hope you enjoyed it. It made you feel pretty good that you come on there. So you play it on the news and blues. Well, young lady, I sure was glad to. And hope everybody out there listening, especially all you folks out there in Beijing, hope you enjoyed that. But this is MPL Studio 13.com coming to you out of Millington Library. And as y'all know by now, we always got our antenna out here looking for some kids or just anybody that's got any kind of talent. Whether Joyce has written a book, Jenny is singing a song right here. So if you got any talent, where you play a guitar or a bugle, or if you're in the art or anything, we welcome you to come down here. And ladies and gentlemen, the best thing about it is free. Don't cost you a red cent. But we're going to get back. Joyce Barnes was today. So Joyce, when you first left over in Arkansas, when you came to Memphis, had you been to Memphis several times just visiting? So you came over. Where did you get your first job, speak of, when you came to Memphis?
I worked for E.H. Crumpin Company down on Front Street.
What were you doing there?
Mortgage servicing.
Were you?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think everybody's heard of Boss Crump. So, anyway, when you came right now, how long did you work there?
I worked there a couple of 3 years, and then I heard about the opportunity on the Navy base.
Okay.
Somebody, I met this gentleman one night that was telling me about the options out here.
Yeah.
And so that, therefore, I got a job working here for the Naval Reserves for at first.
Okay. That's kind of coincidental, ladies and gentlemen out there. Listen, Daddy was out there working at the Naval Base the same time Joyce was. So you don't ever know whose path you're going to cross to. But anyway, do y'all, how many kids you say you had, Joyce? Make sure in case I don't miss that now.
I have four.
Four, where are they?
One lives in Covington.
Right.
Tennessee,
right.
One in Cincinnati, Ohio,
all right.
And one lives, we have a farm over in Arkansas, and one of my daughters lives there.
Okay.
She works for the state, and then I have a son that lives close to Little Rock.
Well, tell us what their names are, because we're going to give them a shout out. So I know two or three of them anyway, but go ahead and tell them. Say hello to them.
Miriam Callahan, my daughter. Roland Hamilton, Michael Hamilton,
right.
And Sandra Hamilton.
All right. Y'all got that now, so your mama been talking to y'all out there. So. All right, give us a, I know you took one trip that was very important to you and overseas. Give us a rundown a little bit on that, Joyce.
You know, it's strange that you ask me. I ran across something last night where I had kept sort of a diary on my trip out there. This was back, I think it was about January, let me see, 2001, I believe. My granddaughter was going to school in Moscow, Russia. So my son Roland, his wife and I went over and visited for a week. And we saw a lot of things that I'd only heard about. Moscow was huge and busy and beautiful when you first entered it, but when you got on the outer edges, it was very poor.
Yeah.
The economy was very bad. And you know, one strange thing I've thought about since then is I saw very few older men. Isn't that strange? I think they all disappeared because of their heavy drinking. That was the impression I got.
Yeah.
Their main way of traveling was subway.
Yeah.
And buses.
Where was this in Moscow?
Mm-hmm.
Was it?
My granddaughter was going to college in Volodymyr. That was about 100 miles or so from Moscow.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So it was very interesting. She had a lot of things planned for us. We went to one of the famous bathhouses. That was interesting.
Yeah.
Everything was very cheap. You didn't pay very much. We went to the theater once. Oh, and you'll get a kick out of this. Before we left, we actually, my granddaughter was had a house mother, and in this same building, there was another really good friend of hers, of the house mother. So before we left, they took us to a real nice theater. They had a floor show. I mean, we had some dancing girls that came in. It was just us. No other people were present. There was no other, we saw no other men. That just kept being, it was impressive to me. No men. Where did the babies come from? You know, I kept asking myself. But anyway, what was interesting, I think, was that it was playing some beautiful music, and this one lady, I had just met her. She was across the room from me. And it was just some really danceable music, and her eyes, she caught my eye, and I smiled, and she sort of, we couldn't speak each other's language, but she just kind of gave me the high sign, would you like to dance? So we got out on the dance floor, she and I, and we danced several times. She'd say something to me, I'd smile like I understood her, but that was just a lot of fun. I look back on that. But see, some of these things I'm remembering is because I just read about them last night. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I know you had one, was it Lenin's, coffin you saw?
That was on Red Square. His body was preserved, we saw so many things, I don't even know if I could recall them right now. We saw the, plane that flew first in Russia?
Sputnik.
We saw it. It was suspended. Right. Yeah, suspended way up in the air. We saw that. I just can't think right now what all we did see.
Yeah, well, I understand.
But it was
that,
great. It was a great trip. I really had a good time.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've got Joyce Varner here, and we're talking to her about her book. Let me see your book now. Every time somebody looks up, I want to see Walking on Hot Coals there, right there. Now, tell everybody where you can get this book, Joyce.
This book from me on my email, joycevarner@att.net. joycevarner@att.net. Anyone that contacts me there, I could mail them a copy.
Okay.
Also here in the Millington Library, they're here. They're over in Arkansas, and in the Woodruff County Monitor, that's the newspaper. That's where I could.
So she got this book all over the place, ladies and gentlemen. So you better go out there and buy it if you want to know about her life and how it's mixed around there and how it's written there. Because you had a couple more things now, Joyce. I know that you've written for her. What are some of them?
Well, I am in the process now of writing the second book, No Wood, No Fire. Mm-hmm. I'm about halfway through this. I'm real caught up in this at the moment.
Yeah.
I have written, though, in the past, probably 50 or 60 short stories. And my son and I, over the one in Little Rock, and I are working on this one book that will be coming out soon of short stories.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, now, we got folks out there that I know I've had several people approach me and say, you know, I'd like to write a book. How'd you write your book? And so give the audience out there listening to you right now, give them a little idea how you came about. And I know you said you wanted to do it for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, when did you drive the nail in the wood right there and hit it with a hammer and say, that's it, I'm going to do it?
I can't remember when, because I've always left or right. Always. I think you have a calling. You have a desire. I always had a great desire to write, and so I have done so. I still write because the best advice I could give someone is this. Of course, I've gotten into some writing classes. I've bought a lot of books that will teach you how to write.
Okay.
But you got to go back to your own style.
Okay.
And the best time I find to write is early in the morning. I feel more able to...
Pressure?
Well, there's pressure otherwise.
Like fresh
thing in the morning. Well, it's not a pressure.
No, fresher.
Oh, fresher. Yeah. Okay, we're...
Yeah. We're pretty close. I mean, we're speaking Southern.
That's true. And the folks out there don't know, but I've known you for a long, long time.
Yeah, but
and that you're personal friend.
Yeah, well, the thing about the writing is after, to give his kids or anybody that had big kids won't do writing, there's several people, adults, one thing another approached me, like I said, about writing. So you wrote it, and then, okay, now you've got it written, you got a thing called publishing it. How did that transpire, George?
Well, that also came about by reading books on publishing in magazines. I don't know, I see on the internet where you can get books that will teach you how to go about publishing a book.
But you got an individual to publish yours.
Well, I self-published, yes.
Yeah, self-published.
Uh-huh.
So the thing that you can tell them to do like you did, when a lot of times, ladies and gentlemen, you go out there and you get the agents and you get this, that, and that, and it costs you a ton of money. And there are avenues that you can do, get an individual to publish it for you.
Mm-hmm.
And you save yourself a lot of money. The only difference is you got to publicize it. And of course, how did you get some information published out about yours now, Joyce?
You mean, how did I find out?
No, you went out and you had book signings.
Oh, when I had the book signings.
Yeah.
Well, let's see. I went to the Memphis Library, for one thing, met a bunch of authors. We interacted and gave each other their cards. Also, I guess one of the main supports I've had is through the publisher of a newspaper in Arkansas. I knew her personally, so she advertised my book in her paper, also gave me a book signing there. And also in the county seat over in Augusta, Arkansas, they had a book signing for me there. So I've had several in Arkansas as well as here.
Yeah, I know you had several of your friends and different acquaintances and one thing or another that are always interested in seeing, you know, and that's always fun. You get paid a lot of people on swap stores and one thing or another. But, ladies and gentlemen, this is MPLStudio13.com coming to you, and we're talking to Miss Joyce Parner, who's written a book. And that's kind of what we're doing on our show on News and Blues, is give somebody incentive, give them a shot of encouragement, and tell them what you can do. There's so many people that you want to do it, whether it's write a book, play the guitar. You come on down here to the library, 872-1585. We'll put you on this show with News and Blues. The best part about it, I keep saying, don't cost you anything, because if you go down to Memphis somewhere and they want to help you or so forth, of course, there's money involved in one thing or another. But anyway, that's what we're talking to Joyce Varner today. And while we're waiting right here, I got a good song I'm going to play. You probably never heard of it. Well, I bet you have, because it's probably older than most of you that have heard something like this, but we're going to play you one anyhow, so see if you recognize it. This might wake you up a little bit. Might throw somebody off ceiling here in a minute. Lucille and Little Richard. Can't tell me that part. Guess you'd have to call that a little rock and roll right there.
Yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one to dance too.
Yeah. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, right there, I want you to know that that was Little Richard. And that was recorded back in the 50s. Now, you might hear a little scratching. You might hear some hissing or one thing or another. This is not any of those cleaned up records or CDs or anything. That's some of my old stuff out of the closet right there. It's an authentic Little Richard record he recorded back in. I've had for a long time since I love my music so much. But ladies and gentlemen, that's MPL Studio13.com coming to you. Downtown Bennington, Tennessee, in the beautiful library here. I want to welcome all of you. Why don't you come down here and if you got something, you can play the piano, sing, or anything you want to do. We got Mr. Josh Coleman as editor and producer and director, and I don't know, he does everything. I mean, he's a genius, and I couldn't do this without him. All I can do is talk a little bit, and it's all Southern, so if we get by, I can do it. So I want to thank Joyce for coming out here today. Joyce, anything else that you want to tell us about your wonderful book? Give them a little incentive to read that thing.
Well, I would like to refer to the back page, the back cover, rather. The back cover.
Yeah.
That was the Twin Towers, which had just fallen about 2 weeks
before. Is that right?
Right. I don't know whether he can get a picture of that or not, but that's the Twin Towers.
Oh, okay.
Which no longer exists.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I want to thank a little lady, Jenny Subiot. Well, let me have that CD. I hope y'all enjoy listening to her sing. That's a mighty fine, good gospel song. We always have those. We always enjoy them. So I'm great to heart, Jenny. You done a great job there. So, ladies and gentlemen, we've had Miss Joyce Varner on here talking about her book, and we've enjoyed having you, Joyce. Appreciate you coming.
Thank you.
And husband Merle, nice enough to come. And I believe after hearing some of the things that happened to you, and I heard that you had this incentive, this burning desire to write a book. Is look square, take the camera right up there and tell them, Joyce.
I love writing. I write every day, and the best time, as I said, is early in the morning because your creative juices are running then. I have good support from my husband. He encourages me in this. So I will probably write as long as I can hold a pen in my hand. I think that everyone that has a talent, as you said, should pursue it. Now, you don't know that I also play the guitar. I learned how to play when I was a teenager.
Oh, you did?
I did. That was one talent I didn't mention to you. But anyhow, to the young people that are listening to us today, this is a great opportunity for you to come and get your talent exposed, because you will get great encouragement from Otis Griffin. And I appreciated them inviting me today so that I could get the word out to all of you young people, anyone that's interested in something creative, just go with it. You'll enjoy it, and it will actually become a calling to you if you pursue it. And
well,
thank you,
Joyce, for coming today. It's always fun. Always, you and Merle always such fine Christian people and fun to be around. We got the genius Josh over, and if it wasn't for him and a few more people, we couldn't be doing this. I just feel like it's something to, we pay back, give back, to try to the community, try to help folks, and we couldn't do this without, several people done. So we appreciate everything, and if we, I look up there and that clock on the wall says we don't have to go home, but we're going to have to get out of here. So I'm going to let the Ravens get us out of here in a few minutes, but ladies and gentlemen, y'all keep tuned. If you got any friends, call them, tell them to punch up there on that Google thing. I don't know how to do it. Wife does. And see if you can listen to us on there if you like us. We're going to bring the Ravens in here. 1948. Love that thing. Been with us for a long time. Thank all of you for tuning in. God bless you. Take care of yourself. Appreciate what you got. Don't complain about what you ain't got. So until the next time, vaya con Dios. See y'all later.
Zipping hang up the victory. That's enough.
Oh.